Now MPs are to debate whether large companies should be forced to publish figures showing the pay gap between male and female employees. Labour says that on average, women earn £210,000 less than men during their careers. The campaign's obtained the backing of high-profile women from all walks of life, including business, politics and the media.
Women are still only earning 81 pence for every pound that men earn in this country. And if we carry on at the current rate, it's going to take another 52 years, 52 years, for that pay divide to disappear. I mean, you know, we've been waiting 44 years since the Equal Pay Act. It shouldn't take a century.
Well, that is the subject of today's Sky Debate. Are women unfairly paid less than men? How real is the pay divide between men and women? And should firms be shamed over it? Well, joining us now to discuss that are the feminist activist and comedian Kate Smurthwaite and Kate Andrews, who's head of communications at the Adam Smith Institute. Before we get started, though, a reminder that you can join the debate too. Tweet at Jane Secker-Sky, including the hashtag SkyDebate. Text 84501 or email news@sky.com and let us know what you think or if there are any points you want to put to the guests, and we'll try to read out some of your comments as we go along. Kate Andrews, let's start with you. We know that women are paid less than men. The facts are incontrovertible. But do you think it's fair? Do you think women deserve to earn less? Of course, they take time off to have children, don't they? They often want to work part-time when they come back. Why should they be paid the same as their male colleagues?
Well, there's no doubt that women still face hurdles in the workforce, but these hurdles seem to be there despite the fact that their employers tend to pay them more money, that their employers tend to promote them more in certain circumstances. The Office of National Statistics found just a couple of weeks ago that women aged between 20 and 40 tend to earn, on average, 1.1% more than their male counterparts. And another recent study found that if women don't exit the workplace, they tend to get promoted more aggressively than their male counterparts. So it doesn't seem to be the case that employers are trying to pay women less based on their gender. It seems to be other factors that are creating this gap. And most of them are cultural. Most of them have to do with the fact that women are leaving the workplace to have children, or they're choosing jobs to make it easier to have children. And that's a problem for us. That's a problem for society. It's not something that government should be legislating against. Perhaps we have unfair expectations and traditional expectations on women that shouldn't exist in 2014.
Well, let's put those points to Kate Smurthwaite. Is that a fair point, Kate? You know, it's just reflecting society. Employers aren't sitting there looking at their pay scales and going, oh, she's a woman, we can get away with paying her a bit less. They're simply reflecting what society thinks.
Well, I mean, first of all, this idea that it all comes down to women choosing to have children, et cetera, et cetera. There's almost three things I need to say about that. Firstly, I don't want to live in a world where people who choose to have children are then unable to get good work afterwards and unable to continue their careers. Secondly, if women were paid more equally and treated more fairly in the workplace, I think there's a good chance we'd see more of them wanting to come back to work full time, wanting and being able to afford childcare and wanting to take that on. And if you're in a relationship, a male-female relationship, and the guy is earning much more than the woman, the decision for her to take the time off to look after the children might well not even be a cultural or a social one. It might well just be a practical one, that the higher earner has to be the one that keeps working. So we should be challenging these things at every step of it. But also, I don't believe that women's life choices are actually what's driving the pay gap. If that were the case, we would reasonably expect to see that women who have reached the top of their professions across the board are women who don't have children. You know, let's look at women without a cleaner at home. Are they on a level pegging with men? And the answer is no. In actual fact, it doesn't seem to be the case that women who don't have children are racing through and making it into the higher echelons of our society. If we look at the most successful women in the country, from Margaret Thatcher to Kate Winslet, actually many of them have children. In fact, it doesn't seem to be about these life choices. And bearing in mind that we're talking about women choosing to take on caring roles, now put that into context of the fact that even in the caring industry, where women have all this extra experience, they still earn £100,000 in a lifetime less than their male counterparts in the same industry. So it's clearly not about life choices. It's clearly about not conscious sexism, not people deliberately saying, let's pay all the women a bit less, but women not being taken seriously in the workplace, people assuming women are not ambitious. When women are ambitious, then being told that they're being aggressive and that it's not feminine and all that kind of stuff that all combines together a sort of a million micro incidents of sexism that add up over a lifetime, yes, frighteningly, to
£200,000. Let's let the other Kate get a word in edgeways. Kate, is Kate right that perhaps women don't want to be seen as aggressive in the workplace. I'll give you an anecdote. When I started off in this job, I discovered that a colleague was being paid £2,000 more than me. Went to ask my boss why, and he said, because he asked for it. Women just don't ask. Is that part of the problem?
It may be part of the problem. There's a lot of evidence to suggest that women aren't asking for higher salaries when they first come into the workplace. And that does have an effect on the gender wage gap. But I like so much of what Kate just said, and I completely agree with her, that men who could be staying at home with kids or have a more financially good reason to be staying home with the kids when women and their wives and their partners are earning more, should be. This isn't the case that women should just be staying at home with the kids and we should adopt these traditional aspects. I completely agree that we need to have a complete reform as a whole. Society as a whole needs to change their minds about what women should be doing in the workplace. But to go back to earning less in very specific circumstances when they have the exact same job as the male employees, these statistics are very misleading. They tend to be very broad and group together all different kinds of professions. So doctors and physicians will be in one big group together, or all child-minding professions will be in one big group together. And they will compare GPs who are working 9-to-5 and very important, very good jobs to surgeons who have had 20 years of training, who have very unflexible hours.
What about this comparison? Sorry to interrupt you, but it's been in the news this week because of the leaks from Sony of the emails. The film American Hustle, the two female stars, Jennifer Lawrence and Amy Andrews, they were paid less on the back-end deal, as it's called, the money that they get after the film is successful. They were paid 7%. The men were paid 9%. The two women were the stars of that film. They went on to win Golden Globes. The men didn't. Why were they paid less?
I'm not sure particularly which film we're talking about, but
American
I would have
Hustle.
To ask... Oh, American Hustle.
It was the second biggest grossing film last year.
Okay, thank you. Well, Jennifer Lawrence had a supporting role in that film. I think that very much dictates why she would have less of a stake in that. When it comes to Amy Adams, she got a Golden Globe. I mean, but we don't compare the success of somebody in terms of their artistic ability necessarily to the amount of time that they're actually spending working. Jennifer Lawrence had less shoots to do. She had less time that she had to be in hair and makeup. She had less time to be on the set. And both of these women are absolutely phenomenal.
Women in film spend less time in hair and makeup.
Kate, what's your point?
I'm not sure we can argue that women in film spend less time in hair and makeup. I think they're forced to sustain a much higher beauty standard than men
in
similar
particular
roles.
Film,
obviously.
But look at the two women that we're talking about right now. We're talking about two of the most successful women on the planet. I care about the average woman who's going to work every day,
who's
not being.
Job.
But they're not necessarily getting paid less than the men who do the same jobs. The National Statistics Office, they found that women between the ages of 20 and 40, they found this out a couple of weeks ago, that they are getting paid 1.1% more than their male colleagues. Your point or that they would be more encouraged to come back to the workplace if they were earning as much as their male colleagues just isn't true. They are earning more than their male colleagues on average today. This was found by the British government.
What happens is that when these numbers come out, because there is such a backlash against anybody, and it was really fascinating a minute ago, you were asked, what is it that's causing these kind of discrepancies? And it seemed like no one would say it out loud. I have an answer to that question. It's called sexism. You know, some of it overt, some of it very in your face. I've had various jobs over the years. I've absolutely been told to my face sometimes, oh, we don't really want a woman in this role, this kind of thing. Working as a performer now in comedy, we hear about women, are they funny, etc. I hear it all the time. So there is overt sexism. There's also covert
sexism. I just want to clarify, you think that Jennifer Lawrence and Amy Adams were paid 7% instead of 9%, not because of previous experience, not because of negotiations that they had formerly with potentially their agents, with potentially the movie agency. You think it's because we are inherently sexist and there's just no scenario in which Jennifer Lawrence could possibly be paid less than Bradley Cooper. I mean, to me, that just makes absolutely no sense.
Of course there are films in which you might get paid more, but overall, on average, this is what the pay gap is about. It's not about saying, here's one woman, what does she earn compared to the next guy? It's about saying, overall, as a society, are we valuing men and women equally? And the answer is obviously not. Now, there are two ways of looking at it. Here's the thing. What you are doing is what happens so often on these issues is you pick up on the one statistic. Actually, in this narrow little age range, in this little region, we found women were doing a teeny little bit better. So there you go. There's no problem. Overall, there is a pay gap. Overall, there is a huge pay gap. And is it that women are less intelligent, less capable, less hardworking? I don't believe that's
true.
So what it must be is that somewhere in our society, there is sexual discrimination going on. Not necessarily overt all of the time, although sometimes overt. time just in women not being taken seriously. You talk about why don't women ask for a pay rise, and yet there have been studies which show that when women do ask for a pay rise, they're seen as a nuisance, they're seen as bothersome, they're seen as being, you know, too aggressive, and they're then not only not given it, but marked down for having even asked.
Kate,
women are making very smart choices.
Okay, Kate Andrews, final point to you, because Kate's right, isn't she? She's looking at the overall picture. The pay gap is still 9.6%.
Yes.
Why is it that we have to wait till another 50-odd years for equal pay, according to projections, when the Equal Pay Act was back in 1970? Why do women have to wait?
We are not waiting another 50 years for equal pay. If you are coming into the workforce as a young woman, you are most likely going to be making more now than your male counterpart. And that's something that the British government came up with a few weeks ago. That's not just my personal opinion. If you want to look at the overall spectrum of the situation, you have jumped from saying that there is a pay gap and thus it must be sexism. And we've completely ignored the fact that women are still choosing to stay home with their children, that men are not being helpful enough to stay home with their children, that women are making more than their male counterparts before they leave the workplace, that they're more likely to get promoted than their male counterparts when they're in the workplace. You've jumped over all of these very important facts that contribute
sexism
to the wage gap.
You won't even say the word. What about sexism? Surely you've got to admit that some of it is plain old-fashioned sexism.
Well, of course there is still sexism in various parts
of our
society.
Well, let's challenge that in this
very niche
way by making companies publish their pay gap. It's not a big ask. We're only talking about companies with 250 employees.
I would love to challenge sexism in a real way, but asking companies to publish arbitrary numbers when they broadly categorize different occupations together that shouldn't be categorized together, to put it out to the public with no context, is gender-based. That is not helping women. That is not addressing sexism whatsoever.
We have to end it there. I would love to continue it for the rest of the morning, but we can't. I'm afraid we're out of time. Thank you both very much.
Coming up in the next hour, the latest from Peshawar.